my dear brothers and sisters. I have the great pleasure tonight to welcome everyone, and the Holy Spirit is here to teach us once more as usual. And so we are going to take a quick reading from the scripture, Revelation chapter 22. Thank you, Jesus. Revelation chapter 22. Thank you, Jesus. Verse 15 to 17. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And I'm reading from International Standard Version. International Standard Version. And the Bible says, Outside are dogs, sorcerers, immoral people, murderers, idolaters, and everyone who loves and practices falsehood. Verse 16, I, Jesus, have sent my angel to give the testimony, to give this testimony to you for the churches. I am the root and the descendant of David, the bright morning star. The spirit of the bride say, come. Let everyone who hears this say, come. Let everyone who is thirsty come. Let anyone who wants the water of life take it as a gift. And this is the word of the Lord. Yes, Lord. My dear brothers and sisters, the reading we've just read was Jesus talking to the church. Jesus talking to the church on a very crucial subject. At the beginning of the Revelation chapter 22, God opened the eyes of St. John, and he had a vision of the river of the water of life. The river of the water of life. And God started to talk to John on very important issues, concerns in the heart of our Lord. And one of them being that he, that is the Lord Jesus, is the water of life. He told John about this in Revelation chapter 22, verse 1 to 5. Then another thing that is very important to the Lord is that he told John that he is coming soon. This we will find in Revelation chapter 22, verse 6 to 7. Jesus. Then he also gave John a very primary subject. He told John that he, Jesus, is the Alpha and the Omega. Revelation chapter 22, verse 13. Said, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. And then he reminded John again that he is coming soon. And that is the concluding benediction. Jesus presiding over the benediction. My brothers and sisters, in the concluding invitation, Jesus now told John that he is giving an invitation to everyone who is thirsty. He said, let everyone who is thirsty come. Let everyone who is thirsty do what? Come. Let everyone who hears this say, I am available. In other words, the Lord is saying, come, because he wants to give somebody water, a living water. God told John so many things, but we are going to emphasize the ministration of tonight on the message of Jesus in Revelation chapter 22, verse 17, where he says, "Let everyone who is thirsty come. Let everyone who wants the water of life come and take it as a gift." That is where we are focusing tonight. We are going to leave other things that Jesus told John. And this is where we are going to focus. I want you to take your attention to the fact that Jesus said, "Let anyone who wants the water of life take it as a gift." In other words, you're not going to buy it. It is free. All right? My brothers and sisters, this message that God gave to John for the early church is still needed in our own time. This text is its own witness. Someone is inviting us for an opportunity to take a drink to quench our thirst, because we are thirsty. This was not the voice of John the Baptist roaring in the desert. No. This was not the voice saying, "Repent, for the kingdom of God is coming." Mm-mm. That's not the voice. That voice is the voice of Jesus, the water of life, who is telling us that he is the water of life. And he knows that we are thirsty. Okay? As a loving father, he wants to give us the water of life. You see that? We often literally understand, thirst, to mean a desire to drink water or liquid. I mean, if you are thirsty, you want to drink water or you want to take a liquid. That's a drinkable. Amen. Jesus. So if we go by that literal meaning, then Jesus is inviting us to come and satisfy our thirst. To quench our thirst. But you have to be thirsty before you would demand for that water. You seek water when you are thirsty. I mean, this is natural. You only go and seek water to drink when you are thirsty. And Jesus is addressing people who are thirsty. Not everyone. There are people who think they don't need water. There are people who think they are full. There are people who think they don't need Jesus. They're everywhere in the world today. So you have to be thirsty for you to qualify to be part of the community that Jesus is talking to. So I have a question for you tonight. Are you thirsty? Are you feeling spiritually dehydrated, dry? Are you thirsty? If I may ask again, are you thirsty, brother? Do you feel dry in your prayer life? Is your prayer life empty? Do you have an inner curiosity to seek God, but you are struggling with it? You are making efforts, but nothing appears to be working. This is a symptom that you need a water from Jesus. You need a juice from Jesus. Jesus, this night is for you. Jesus will give you a cup of water. Jesus has a jug of juice to give to his children to drink. With that water, you will receive a boost for the spiritual journey. I mean, the journey of faith. Elijah was a great man of God. We all know about Elijah, the great things God used him to do. That God used him to do great exploits in his kingdom. But there was a time in the ministry of Elijah when he was spiritually dehydrated. He started to struggle with prayer. In fact, he even prayed for death. And he petitioned in 1 Kings chapter 19, verse 4, that he wants to die. 1 Kings chapter 19, verse 4 says, "While he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness, he came to a broom bush." a broom bush, sat down under it, and prayed that he might die. I have had enough, Lord, he said. Take my life. I am no better than my ancestors. Would you ever imagine this to be the prayer of Elijah? Huh? A man whose prayer brought down fire from heaven. Would you imagine him to be the man who would pray, God, kill me, I'm tired of life? Let me take you back there again. Do you take notice that in 1 Kings chapter 19, verse 4a, that Elijah went a day's journey into the wilderness, take note of it. Wilderness is a place of dryness. And that was where Elijah found himself. Elijah was indeed feeling dry. He had no motivation to live again. There was no drive in him to encourage him to continue to live. The enemies were everywhere. Jezebel was looking for him. Ahab was looking for him. False prophets were looking for him. Enemies were looking for him here and there. And he thought that he was the only one left in Israel. And now he wished for death. Many of us are like that. Jesus. But I want to let you know something. That God will visit you in that situation. God saw the ugly state of his prophet, Elijah. He saw his state of spiritual dehydration and sent water from the brook for him to drink. How do I know? Because the Bible tells me so. In 1 Kings chapter 17, verse 6, the Bible says, the rebels brought him bread and meat in the morning, and bread and meat in the evening, and he drank from the brook. Do you see that God gave him the water to drink? The water from the brook was from the sanctuary of God. That was not an ordinary water. The water that has a finger of God in it. The water from the sanctuary brings satisfaction, brings hope, brings favor, brings open doors. The water from the sanctuary was made available for Elijah at the brook. The remedy for that your spiritual dehydration is the water from the sanctuary. That is the remedy for our spiritual dehydration. A lot of us are dehydrated. We know how to take care of, clinical dehydration, but we appear to be ignorant of how to handle spiritual dehydration. And that is why God is calling on a lot of us today, the same way he called on Elijah. He said, come and drink the water of life. To do what? To give you strength. To satisfy your thirst. To remove your dehydration. So the remedy for spiritual dehydration is the water of life. Do you want that water? Jesus. Because of the importance of this water, Jesus came out and he was shouting, with the top of his voice. And he was saying, come, all you who are thirsty. He said, come and drink. Are you thirsty? Jesus. Are you thirsty? Do you feel dehydrated? God says, I will give you the water of life. That is the remedy for that spiritual dehydration. And because this is a very important message for Jesus, or from Jesus to you and for me, we are therefore titling this talk, The Remedy for Spiritual Dehydration. The Remedy for Spiritual Dehydration. Now, when we say that somebody is thirsty, you see, thirsty means too eager to get something. You know, we're not going beyond the literal meaning now. We're not looking at the implied meaning, extended meaning. No more just desiring water. But now, thirsty could also mean too eager for something, too eager to get something. You have an ardent desire for something. You are desperate for a change. That means you are thirsty. You are craving for something. You are longing, you know, for something. That is being thirsty. For instance, a dry land needs water. Such land is thirsty. Are you thirsty for survival? Are you thirsty for success? Are you thirsty for a strong prayer life? Are you thirsty for hope? There are people who have lost hope. Are you thirsty for promotion? Are you thirsty for children? It's in the time of Hannah, she was thirsty for a child. In the time of Hagar, the same thing. In the time of Sarah, the same thing. Elizabeth was thirsty for a child. So we're not limiting the vision of thirstiness to, you know, desire to drink water. No. Are you eager for a good news? Are you desperate for something that will glorify God to happen in your life? If the answer is yes, then you are thirsty. Are you desperate to see that change? Are you craving for it? Are you longing for it? In fact, in Ezekiel chapter 47, verse 1 to 12, the water from the sanctuary transformed the desert land, the land of Arabah, into a land with river, a land teeming with life. All right? You know why? Because the water is the sanctuary water. And that water from the sanctuary came to the desert, and they transformed the desert. Because the desert is thirsty. You and I, we are more important to God than the desert. If God would bring that life to the desert and they bring life to desert, then he will do greater things for you and for me. God says he will do the same thing in you and in my life tonight. I want you to take note of what the Bible is saying in Revelation chapter 22, verse 17. He said, whosoever will let this water to come to him will drink this water freely. This water is free of charge. It is Jesus that is giving us this extended invitation. The only ones who will answer the invitation of Revelation chapter 20, verse 17 are those who are filled with the longing for Christ, who are thirsty for the Holy Spirit, who need the power of God, who need revival, those who need the life of Jesus in them. These are the ones who are thirsty, who are thirsty for him. These are the people God wants tonight, brothers and sisters. Jesus is reminding us today that he is the water of life, that he is going further to prompt us to take the water of life. He wants to give us this water. In other words, while he is extending his hand for this offer, we are going to also extend our own hands to receive the water from him. It has been the nature of Jesus throughout his ministry to encounter people and give them this water. In John chapter 4, verse 10, Jesus answered the woman at the well and said unto her, if you knew the gift of God and who it is that said to you, give me to drink, you would have asked of him and he would have given you living water. In other words, Jesus was saying to her, I will give you the water of life. not just physical water, but that water of eternal life which gives life. The water that overcomes sin and unrighteousness. That water heals the sick. That water conquers death. That water transforms situations. No matter how ugly it is, no matter how bad the situation is, the water from the sanctuary is a solution. I don't know what is dehydrated in your life. I don't know what, maybe your kidney is dehydrated. Maybe your entire spiritual life is dehydrated. But I tell you, we are in Jesus' clinic tonight. He's going to give somebody water. I remember some years ago when my mother told me that she was sick and Jesus came and gave her that water to drink and she was healed. You are the next person. He wants to give you that water. The water that will heal your womb. The water that will heal your destiny. The water that will transform your situations. The water that will restore your glory. The water that will make you the temple of God. The temple of glory. The temple of testimonies. Oh, Jesus. Jesus said that he came that we might have life. Remember John chapter 10, verse 10. I have come that you may have life, and life in full. As we are connected to this water, as we are connected to the water of Jesus, that living sanctuary, that living water, as we are connected to him, we will never get dehydrated. That is the problem with Christianity. Many of us, we get disconnected when we open the door for the enemy to come in. And then we'll start getting dehydrated spiritually. And that's what the enemy wants. But God says, as you abide in me, I will restore you. So brothers and sisters, we have been invited to abide in him. So that his life will flow in us and flow out of us. Amen. As we abide in him, his life flows out of us like rivers of living water. It is not a news that living water is flowing from Jesus to the whole world. But what may be a news to you is that water of life is also flowing through you. You see, you need to understand this. There is a water that flows from the life of a child of God. That water flows through him. So the water has a source. The water is flowing from Jesus to his children. And it flows from his children to other children. So when, for example, someone has anointing for healing, for example, the healing does not come from the person. It is the river of healing from Jesus that flows into that person and through that person to people. Jesus. So that's why Jesus is telling us in John chapter 7, verse 38, he that believeth in me, he that believeth in me, as the scripture said, out of his belly shall flow the rivers of living water. Can you imagine? Water flowing out of you? Have you ever thought of that? That's the living water that flows from a child of God. Have you ever thought of that? But that water flows only when you are connected to Jesus. There is always water flowing. It could be a living water, a good water, or an evil water. When somebody is worshiping devil, the water that flows will be the water of crisis. It will be the water of shame. It will be the water that causes problems. Anywhere the person goes, problems everywhere. Because the person is an agent of the devil. But when you are an agent of Jesus, now the power of Jesus will flow through you, bringing hope, bringing light where there's darkness, bringing hope where there's hopelessness. Jesus. Psalm 46 verse 4 says, there is a river, the streams of which shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacles of the Most High. The Bible says that God is in that city. God is in that city. God's in that city that the river of life is flowing from or through. God is in that city. If the river is flowing in you, then you are the city of God. That means that God dwells in you. This is one of the titles of Mary, the mother of Jesus, the city of God. Because in her, Jesus was living. Can you imagine a pregnant woman carrying Jesus inside? Hey, Jesus lives in his city. And that is, in this case, the children of God. Revelation chapter 22 verse 1 says, and he showed me a pure river of water of life, crystal as clear as crystal, let's put it that way. And this water was proceeding out of the throne of God and of the Lamb. This water that John was talking about is the water of life. Receiving Jesus into our lives opens a channel for his water to flow through us, making us to be like him. We are praying today that the power of God will flow into us, that the Holy Spirit will flow into us and flow through us. When he flows in, then you become a channel for him to flow into the life of other people. When you receive that water and you don't extend it, something is wrong. Jesus. So, my dear brothers and sisters, God is telling us, get connected to me, for I shall remove your dehydration. I will remove that thing that is cutting you dry. That thing that is making life full of dryness. That thing that is making your spiritual life to be dry. God says, be connected to me, and I will take care of the rest. Are you going to answer him tonight? I want to imagine Jesus to be like a mighty lake, a mighty reservoir, a mighty ocean of river of life, an infinite river. You know, and I want to imagine all of us to be the tributaries, the delta, the channels. And from him, the life water flows through us. One of the things the devil does is to try to cut off the channel so that we don't receive the power from him. So that we get dehydrated. May God forbid that in Jesus' name. As a little boy, I used to do fishing, you know, in the local river in my village. And one of the ways that we kill fish or catch fish, you know, is by blocking the flow of the river. At some point, you know, when you block the river from flowing, it will cause some fish to get dehydrated. They start gasping for air. And you see the fish hiding in places. You see them willingly coming out. And then you can catch them. And this is what the enemy does to the children of God. He targets to block the flow of that life into you, so that you get dehydrated and then you start suffocating. You see, spiritual death doesn't happen overnight. It's a process. When the enemy wants to dehydrate a child of God, he wants to kill a child of God, what he will first of all do is to make you to become so busy, make you not to have a time for God again, make you not to be going to church, not to be fellowshipping with the Christians, not to be reading the Bible. He wants to pull down your prayer life. By the time this is happening gradually, you may not notice it the first time, but over time, you find that you are degrading, that you are getting dehydrated. And when the dehydration is a prolonged dehydration, then it becomes death. It may take a year or 2 years or 3 years, as the case may be. But we are praying tonight that whatever thing I want to dehydrate my life, let God dehydrate the life of that thing. Jesus. Hello, my dear brothers and sisters. God is talking to us. Do you think you are disconnected? Do you think, or do you feel you are running dry? Are you struggling like those fish out of the water? You think that your spiritual journey has become a struggle? Are you running, you know, rat race like the people of the world? Oh, we remember Adam and Eve, they got disconnected when they ate the tree from the tree. God told them not to eat from that tree, but they ate from that tree. Eating from that tree represents rebellion, represents disobedience to God. Now is the time to pray your way back to the mighty ocean of life for your reconnection. You need to be reconnected. Jesus. A lot of people are too busy that they don't have time for prayer. We are remembering them in prayer tonight, that God will revive our land, revive our families. Yes, Lord. That God will channel this river of life into our health, into our destiny, into our families, into our job, our source of income, into every part of our being. Let this life of what of Christ flow like a river into us in the name of Jesus. This is a time to socket ourselves back to the Lord. I used to imagine, you know, the electricity. When you connect the electric bulb to the wall socket, or the pressing iron, or the fan to the electricity, you see it working. You see the bulb producing light. You see the fan rotating, or the pressing iron, you know, heating up. Why? Because it is drawing power, strength, energy, power from the electricity. And that is what it is for us as children of God. For us to function, for the light bulb or candle or light in order to shine, we have to be connected to Jesus, the light of the world. And the enemy knows that once you are connected to Jesus, that there is nothing you cannot do. And so he wants to make sure you are disconnected. Jesus. One of the ways that lions kill animals is trying to disconnect that animal from the school. Okay? When that animal loses focus, loses fellowship with its fellow animals where they were grazing. It may be an animal of, say, 100, and then you see them walking together, grazing together, playing together. The lion is only after one. And when he's chasing that very one, he wants to island it. That is, cut it off from that group. And then the animal will be running alone. And I tell you, it cannot go far. The lion will tap it. The enemy is that lion. He wants to cut you off from that fellowship with the children of God. Whatever is the strategy of the enemies to disconnect us from fellowshipping with our fellow Christians, to dehydrate us, God is saying, I am here to help you, to connect you to myself, the river of life. That is Jesus talking. He did it for Adam and Eve. The enemy did it for Adam and Eve and succeeded by making them to eat from the tree. But Jesus the second Adam, came back and restored us to our God. St. Paul says that he reconciled us to his Father. Remember the story of the prodigal son. When he was wasting, squandering his father's resources, he thought he was doing the right thing. But there was a day he came back to his senses. And then he decided to go back to his father. That day he made that decision was the day that he started to receive the grace to go back to his father. The prodigal son got reconnected back to the source when he came back to his senses. Maybe tonight is the first day of coming to the prayer line, and you are hearing this message, and God is as well talking to you. He said, I want to give you the river of life. I want you to get reconnected back to me. He said in John chapter 15, verse 1, that he is the vine, and that we are the branches of the vine. There's nothing we can do without him. The Lord is inviting somebody to come back. Inviting somebody to come back. Imagine the enemy blocking off your water channel, from the source. Do you imagine how you feel in the house when your source of water supply is ruptured and you can't get water again? You don't feel comfortable. There is no life that will be full of comfort without Jesus. We cannot allow the enemy to suffocate us. We cannot allow the enemy to dehydrate us. Never! In the name of Jesus. Jesus. My dear brothers and sisters, whatever spirit that is building a dam in your river, building a dam so that you'll be cut off from that water of life. Whatever way they are building a dam, using enemies, using ungodly friends, using things that will not glorify God in order to cut us off, in order to build a dam so that we will not receive freely from that life. May the power of our Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth, who used Joshua in the time of the old to pull down the walls of Jericho, let him through his ministration tonight pull down every dam that has been built, every construction project to build a dam against me so that I will be cut off. We command those dams in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Let them be destroyed now. Let them be destroyed now. In the name of Jesus, every word of Jericho against my life, against my future life, causing me to be dehydrated, making me to be dehydrated, or causing my children to be dehydrated, or making my family to be dehydrated. May the power of Jesus, the power of his glory, destroy such powers. In the name of Jesus, yes, my Lord. In the name of Jesus, let the blood of Jesus fight for me now. Fight for us now. Oh, Jesus, come and vindicate your people. Come and fight your battle. Come and fight the battle of your people. In the name of Jesus, we declare that we shall recover our identity, that we shall recover our stand in our relationship with God. Oh, Jesus, we are ministering the blood of Jesus upon everyone. Let this blood cover somebody. Let this blood flow upon somebody. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. Yes, Lord. Touch my people. Touch my people. Touch my people. In any way, the enemies want to blood it, the channel of river of life, in my family, in my destiny. Oh, Father, let such spirits be destroyed now. In the name of Jesus. Jesus. Oh, maybe this dam may be built because of unforgiveness. Sometimes we open the doors for the enemy to build a dam. It may be unforgiveness. You don't know that when you are carrying unforgiveness, you are giving the enemy the instrument to build a dam. Or you may be living a life of resentment. Whatever it is that enemies are using to build a dam in order to make me to be dehydrated. May the Holy Spirit help us. Yes, Lord. Let the Holy Spirit touch us. Let the Holy Spirit destroy that dam. For we want to have a free connection, an interflow of the word and the river of life in our lives in the name of Jesus. We are asking the Holy Spirit to reconnect us to our Lord Jesus. Let him strengthen us. Father, touch your people. Father, touch your people. Father, touch your people. Jesus, Holy Father, consciously, we are now beginning to reconnect ourselves to you, Papa. You are the mighty river. Oh, Jesus, Father, let your river flow. Let your river flow in the name of Jesus. Jesus, let your Holy Spirit flow. Flow into your people. Flow into your children. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus, let your Spirit flow. In the name of Jesus. You are the river of life. Father, you are the word of God. Come and flow now. Flow into your people. Flow into your people. In the name of Jesus. Jesus, you are the pure river. The pure river of Revelation chapter 20 verse 1. You are the pure river. The river of life. Clear as a crystal. Proceeding out of the throne of God and of the Lamb. Holy Father, we need this crystal water. This water that heals. This water that revives. This water that makes people to be like you. Holy Father, let this river flow into the life of your children. In the name of Jesus. Jesus, flow, 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 flow. Ask him to flow now. As he is flowing, let him destroy everything that is making us to be downcast. In the name of Jesus. Jesus, 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 flow into my life, flow into my life, into my family, and water me, and water the family, and water my destiny, in the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord, Jesus, let the blood of Jesus flow now and touch your people. Touch your people, Lord. Anyone that is in the valley, any man or woman whose life is in a valley, may this water flow, this river of life, may he locate you there. May he locate you in that valley, in the name of Jesus. And may he transform you and elevate you and pull you out from that valley, in the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus, come and touch your people, in the name of Jesus. People that are living in dark places, let the river of life locate you there. And bring the light of Jesus in the name of Jesus. Jesus, every obstacle against my salvation be destroyed now. As the river is flowing in the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus, every desert in my life, every unfruitfulness in my life, every dryness in my life, hey, in the name of Jesus, I command you to disappear in the name of Jesus. Get out of my life. Get out of my business. In the name of Jesus. For the river is flowing now. The river of life. That river is flowing now. In the name of Jesus. Jesus, touch your people. Touch your people. Touch your people. In Ezekiel chapter 47, verse 1 to 12. And the Bible tells us, there is a river from the altar, from the center of God. And this water, this very river, flowed into Araba, and they transformed the dry land, and they flowed into the desert, and they transformed the desert, and made it a life to be with life, a land to be with life. Oh, Jesus, oh, Robo Shereba, let this water, this living water, transform me now, transform my barrenness, transform my situations, in the name of Jesus. Every district of barrenness in my life, let them be destroyed now. Let them be destroyed now. In the name of Jesus. Jesus. My dear people of God, in agriculture, there is something called irrigation. Simply, a channel that supplies water to the farmland. When the farmer develops the land, plants his seeds or plants, he must also consider that it is necessary to provide water to that plant or to the farm. He does it by irrigation. He creates a channel through which water will flow to supply life to the plant. Without irrigation, the plant will die. The farm will die. There is a divine irrigation that the angels of God, the heavenly civil engineers, they are going to come down to build an irrigation that will connect you, your family, your life, your business to Jesus, so that that business will not dry up, brother. So that your life will not dry up. Jesus, open your heart and pray and say, Lord, let these heavenly engineers, these civil engineers from heaven, let them build a divine irrigation to connect my life to you, Lord. To connect my family to you, Lord. To connect my anointing to you, Lord. To connect my children to you, Lord. To connect my promotion to you, Lord. To connect my stuff income to you, Lord. In the name of Jesus, I refuse to dry up. I refuse to dehydrate. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus, bring your water, divine irrigation, into my life, into your people, into the prayer line, into this ministry. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. Jesus. My people pray now. My people pray now. Pray, 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 pray. Call upon the Lord now. He will answer you. The river of life. That is his name. Jesus. We are calling on you. For the Bible says, Revelation chapter 22, verse 17, that you are the water of life, and that you want to give all this water free of charge. Holy Father, let my life be saturated with this water. Drench me with your water. In the name of Jesus. Oh, Jesus, touch our people. Touch our people. Touch our people. Touch our people. In the name of Jesus. Jesus. Oh, I have a question for somebody. Can you imagine a boat on the river? Imagine a boat on the river. That boat floats as long as the river is there. But my question is, what do you think will happen to the boat if the river dries up? If the river dries completely and everywhere is sand, do you think the boat will float again? Do you think the boat will move? Of course not. The boat gets crippled if the river dries up. The boat cannot move again. It will be grounded. The boat could mean your business. All right? It could mean your family. It could mean your destiny. It could mean your prayer life. It could mean your career. That's what the boat could mean. Remember that disciples of Jesus were in the boat. And the storm came. And they were afraid. But Jesus walked on the sea and came to them. And he calmed the storm. That means boats could be threatened. All right? But what of a case where a boat sinks on the sand or rests on the sand? You see, in the time of Noah, the Noah's ark was on top of the flood and was floating. But the Bible recorded that there was a day in the 10th month of the flood, the boat of Noah, otherwise called Noah's ark, was now resting on the top of the mountain. At that point, it was not moving again. When your boat is resting on the sand, on a rock, you cannot move again. So this means that business sinks when river is dried up. Maybe the enemy has cut off the life of the business, of the family, of the destiny, so that the boat will sink or rest on the water or on the sand. This was the case of Jabez. His destiny was cut off. And his boat was resting on the sand. But he started to cry to God. As he started to cry to God, in 1 Chronicles chapter 4, verse 10, God heard him. The Bible says, in 1 Chronicles chapter 4, verse 9 to 10, that Jabez cried out to the God of Israel, "Oh, that you would bless me and enlarge my territory. Let your hand be with me and keep me from harm, so that I will be free from pain." And God granted his request, period. In a nutshell, Jabez's boat was sitting on the sand because the enemy has cut off the water, cut off the river, so it would not move, so that the boat of Jabez would not move. All right? People were getting married, but not Jabez. People were getting job, but not Jabez, because his boat was sitting on the sand. Does it make sense now? So he was stagnant. All right? Not a moose. Now, life could be stagnant. Business could be stagnant because for the same reason, that the boat of that business, of that life, of that destiny is sitting on the sand. But Jabez cried to God. He did not cry to human beings. He did not go to his friends to complain to them, to attract sympathy. No. And like Jabez, we shall cry to God to channel the river of life into our business, into our family, into our destiny, into our career, into our prayer life, into our life, in the name of Jesus. We pray now that our boats will begin to move on the water, not on the sand. Boat is not meant to be sitting on the sand. Anyone whose boat is sitting on the sand, under the anointing of the power of Jesus, let the river appear. Let the river show up. Let the river of life locate that boat. Locate that grounded boat. Anyone whose boat is grounded, whose children are grounded, whose destiny is grounded, whose business is grounded, may the power of Jesus Christ of Nazareth locate you now. Locate you now. Locate at your boat now. I command that boat now. In the name of Jesus, begin to float now. Begin to float now. Begin to float now. Jesus, I command that sand to turn into a river. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus, I command that sand bear, to turn to river, so that your boat will begin to move. In the name of Jesus. So that your business, so that your destiny, so that your career will begin to move. In the name of Jesus. Jesus, pray now, pray now, pray now. Abokorobo, any power that wants to grant me, that wants to keep me stagnated, that wants to keep me one place, Ribo Sharaba, let them be destroyed now. In the name of Jesus, pray now, pray now, pray now, pray now. Jesus, I will not end this year. I will not end this year the same. I will not end this year the same way I enter this year. I will exit this year better than, more celebrated than I entered the year. In the name of Jesus, I refuse to be stagnated. I refuse to be one place. I refuse it. I must move forward. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. Jesus. My people pray now. Call upon him now. The mighty power of Jesus. Let him flow now. Ask him to touch you. Ask him to touch you. In the name of Jesus. 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 Pray now, pray now, pray now. Yes, my Lord. Every power hindering me, every power hindering my advancement in life, be destroyed now. In the name of Jesus, every power, hey, posing a stumbling block in my life, I command you now, be destroyed now. Yes, my Lord. yourselves. Come and glorify yourself in my career, in my marriage, in the name of Jesus. Let this marriage begin to move forward. Let this marriage begin to be fruitful. Let this marriage begin to be juicy. Let this marriage begin to be sweet. Let this marriage begin to be light, begin to be lightened in the name of Jesus. Every darkness, oh, covering my marriage, I command them now, be broken now, be broken now. My people, pray now. Something is happening now. Something is happening now. Pray, 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 pray. Pray yourself to breakthrough. Pray yourself to breakthrough in the name of Jesus. Oh, Jesus. We are praying that every stumbling block, every constitution of hindrances in my life, let them turn to stepping stones for our progress in the name of Jesus. Yes, Lord. Jesus, let the King of Glory of Psalm 25, verse 7 and 9 appear in our situations. Appear in our situations in the name of Jesus. Jesus, let him appear and intervene in our affairs in the name of Jesus. Jesus, bring your light upon your children in the name of Jesus. Father, take over. Papa, take over. Papa, take over in the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord, every Red Sea in my life. Oh, Jesus, we command that Red Sea in the name of Jesus. Dry up. Dry up! Dry up! Aha! Pray that prayer right now. Every Red Sea in my life, we command to dry up in the name of Jesus. Every wall of Jericho in my life, causing hindrances in my life, we command you now in the name of Jesus. Be put down. Be put down in the name of Jesus. Every Goliath stand on my way, be put down. Receive the stones of fire. Receive the stones of fire. In the name of Jesus, Jesus, the power is moving now. The power is moving now. In the name of Jesus, every spirit causing bad dreams in my life, every spirit causing bad dreams in my life, I command you now, burn by fire. In the name of Jesus, yes, my Lord, Jesus, I must overcome the enemies. In the name of Jesus, I must overcome the enemies. Because the Bible tells me in 1 John chapter 5 verse 4 that whosoever is born of God is an overcomer. Therefore, I am an overcomer. I am an overcomer. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. And the Bible says, John chapter 16 verse 33, this is I've told you. Believe in me. Herebo Shereba. He said, I have overcome the world. Jesus is an overcomer. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus, I belong to the club of overcomers. Anointing for overcomers is upon my life now. In the name of Jesus, yes, my Robert Shereba, from today, I will move forward. In the name of Jesus, pray prayer now. Jesus, receive the strength to move forward. For the Bible says, Isaiah chapter 40, verse 31, but they that wait upon the Lord, they shall renew their strength. And they shall mount up like with wings as the eagle. And they shall run, and they will not weary. And they shall walk, and they shall not faint. Therefore, in the name of Jesus, I shall not faint. My business shall not faint. My career shall not faint. I shall not be weary. In the name of Jesus, my womb shall not faint. I shall not be weary. In the name of Jesus, Jesus, every power erecting stumbling blocks for me, you are wasting your time. Because in the name of Jesus, you have been destroyed already. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus, let the blood of Jesus begin to touch you now. Begin to touch you now. Begin to touch you now. In the name of Jesus. Every burden on my shoulder, let the water of life remove them now. Remove them now. Jesus, my people pray now. Call upon him now. Call upon Jesus. Call upon Jesus. He will see you through. Call upon him now. Yes, my Lord. Jesus, touch your people. Touch your people. Touch your people. Transform your people. In the name of Jesus, the blood of Jesus, the blood of Jesus is flowing now. The blood of Jesus is flowing now. Let our blood flow. blood. Let our blood touch you. Let our blood touch you. Let our blood touch you. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. I'm incredible. The blood of Jesus. The blood of Jesus. Fight my battle. The blood of Jesus. Vindicate me. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. I command every obstacle in my life. Let them turn into blessings. In the name of Jesus. I command every obstacle to the free flow of your river in me. Let them begin to be destroyed. In the name of Jesus. Jesus, give me the power to bring life to those who need to know you, or those who do not know you. Oh, Jesus, I want to know you more. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus, every desert in my life, Holy Father, turn them to a garden of Eden. Turn them to a garden of glory. In the name of Jesus. Turn them to a garden of roses. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, mighty God. Blessed be your name, Papa. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We cover ourselves with the blood of Jesus. We cover our going out and coming in with the blood of Jesus. And we are decreeing that no weapon formed against us shall prosper. In the name of Jesus. It is well. It is well with the children of God. It is well with every one of us. Thank you, Jesus. We begin to cover ourselves now with the blood of Jesus. We begin to cover ourselves now with the blood of Jesus. Begin to cover the blessings you received in the course of the prayer with the blood of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. Thank you, Papa. Blessed be your name, O God. Thank you, Ancient of Days. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.